Bye-bye.
I've taken the measure 532 to 98% of the production.
Okay, nice. Well, I'm going to talk about the Cosmos DB today, and I'm going to try to go fast in the beginning here. First, let me talk about myself. I can start. My name is Hasan Savran. I am business intelligence architect at Progressive Insurance. My team is responsible for daily analytics of claims and reps. We use mostly SQL Server for our data. We use ABC.NET for our web applications, and we use SVG custom graphs for custom graphs for our applications. Those are specifications are really for our my team. Progressive has much more than that. So if you like to learn about Progressive more, or if you are thinking about, you know, changing, looking for opportunities, you can check our website here, or you can ask me after this session. I'll be happy to answer any of your questions. You can follow me on the Savran Lab. That's my Twitter account. I share some good information out there. Also, I'm the vice president of North Ohio SQL Server Group. I am in charge of Akron and Canton area. And our SQL survey is coming up February, so you'll be able to see you all out there. It's free SQL Server training. All right, so this is the agenda we are going to cover today. I'm going to look at the history of the Cosmos DB first. Then we are going to move to the global distribution option of Cosmos DB. We are going to try to figure out how the scalability works in the Cosmos DB. We will check always available option, multi-model data models. It sounds like it kind of explains itself, but it's really, it can be confusing. We are going to look at relational database problems that Cosmos DB might, you know, be helpful for. And we are going to look at resource model architect of the Cosmos DB documents. And we are going to look at the partition. Partitioning is one of the main, the big topics here. And it's very important because if you pick the wrong partition, really your project might fail. So, and we will check the pricing, and we will figure out how actually Microsoft is going to charge you if you use the Cosmos DB. And we will look at the Cosmos DB tools, and I will show you how to actually set up the Cosmos DB. Let's talk about the history of Cosmos DB first. Cosmos DB used to be a document DB. That was the name of it. And one of those Microsoft conferences, Microsoft actually announced that document DB was going to be Cosmos DB. So if you were using the document DB before, it used to be only storing JSON objects in cloud. And the developers were able to retrieve the data, insert the data, or update the data by SQL-like language. It was like a SQL API in document. When Cosmos DB came up, really developers did not lose anything, but Cosmos DB added a lot of new features to document. But why did we actually, why do we need it, right? Many people ask, like, why do we need new databases? Well, the first answer is Microsoft actually had the problem maybe 3 or 4 years ago. Microsoft is a large company, and they have teams in every country, every continent. And some of those teams actually working together. The problem is when they tried to share the data, that was not really an easy way. Sharing data securely and fast. So they came up with their own kind of database systems they were using. And when it actually proved itself, they started to, you know, publish in public and start to make money. So Cosmos DB is mostly for high-scale OLTP systems. So it truly makes sense if you're a large company and you need to share data globally and really access the data fast. So if you really think about it, for example, Hadoop came, right? Hadoop came, one of the main reasons it came up is, well, we had too much data, and our database servers couldn't handle the analyzing it. So they needed another way to actually analyze this data. So they came up with the Hadoop idea. The Hadoop works great if you're analyzing the data, but you cannot really do that much when it comes to OLTP. It's not that fast.
When it comes to what?
OLTP, which is like if you want to use on the website, that's not going to happen. Cosmos DB is actually working the same way. That was actually research from IBM 2 or 3 years ago. And they find out that 90% of the data we have right now out there is generated in the last 2 years. So if you just think about it, like computers has been out there for a long time, and we actually generated 90% of this data in the last 2 years. That's a big number. All of the cloud and all of the cloud solutions, of course, you know, is one of the reasons. But if you really think about it, our new web applications, when we generate them and we create them, they actually create, they generate more data than before. There are more resources and they generate more data. That's kind of like a challenge when you pick a database system, especially like if you pick a SQL Server, that will be a challenge if you your company will grow up and if it will become a global application. It's going to be a challenge for SQL Server because it's not easy to scale SQL Server, especially if you're not in cloud. So Cosmos DB is actually is going to give you a lot of options if you are in one of those cases.
Isn't it
GraphQL
DB also?
Yes, it includes it. So now let's look at the options we have that Cosmos DB has. The first one is the global distribution. Why do we need global distribution? Well, as I said before, if you have a big company, you are going to have all kind of branches in many places. You don't have to be a big company. You can be just like a web application, and it's a global application, like it can be a game, right? If you have users in China, if you have users in Asia somewhere, your data should be close to that user because the latency is going to be less than people actually going to enjoy your application. For example, let's talk about eBay, right? What do you do in eBay? You go to eBay and you know, bid on stuff. And many people bid on that stuff, and that's how eBay makes money. Well, let's say our eBay server is in the United States, right? And there are people in Asia trying to bid on the same thing with you. Well, the latency of those people in Asia is going to be much higher than you. And really, they are not going to be able to win the items that you are bidding. So what is that going to get hurt is the users are going to get frustrated and stop probably using eBay, first of all. The second, whoever is selling that item, if those people from the other places can bid on it, actually the price is going to go up. That means the person who's selling it is going to be happy. And eBay is going to be happy because the price is up and they're going to get, you know, more money, more cut. So it is important for you to actually have your data close to the user. Global distribution just gives you that. And it comes with the package. You don't need to pay anything extra. Of course, if you turn it on, you're going to kind of put the data more out there, so you're going to pay more for the data storage and other stuff, but you don't really pay if you compare a SQL Server. If you're going to pick another SQL Server here, you're not going to start to worry about licenses of other SQL servers. Cosmos DB is not like that. So in here, my application is in Virginia here, as you can see east. In the last conference, actually, Cosmos DB just announced that you can have multiple servers which will accept write access. So you can have one of your servers here and one of your servers here, and people in Asia will write here, United States will write here, and SQL, the Cosmos DB will sync it at the end, in the back end. So you don't need to worry about syncing the data.
So that's some sort of like quorum and eventual consistency?
Yeah.
Okay.
You have five processes that can power. So, as you can see, this is actually from the Cosmos DB page. If you want to distribute your data, one of your items, those items are actually data centers of Azure. All you have to do is you just need to pick one of them and click save. That's all you have to do. I mean, think about it in SQL Server if you try to do that. You need to worry about licensing first. It's going to cost you more money. And if you're going to do that, you better have a good DBA because if it's going to get unsync, it's going to be not easy to figure it out, the data. Also in here, you have options, manual failover and automatic failover. So if you want to test how actually it's going to act, you can turn one of them off and you will see all the traffic is going to the other one. And as I said before, now actually supports multiple write regions.
So in this example, you don't have any read regions. Does this mean no one can read, or?
Read and write is the same.
Oh, read or write. Okay. So
this is just a simple one.
It's just not a read. So it's a read only or read write.
That's
okay.
And the other great things about the Cosmos DB is, let's say we go to eBay and we say, all right, you know what, we are going to open some more Cosmos DBs here. As soon as we are going to actually turn this on and click save, I think if your database is less than 100 terabytes, that data will be available wherever you pick less than 30 minutes. And as soon as it becomes available, all your clients close to that will be redirected to that, whichever you pick actually. So you don't need to elevate any applications in your end. The API, Cosmos DB's API, is smart enough to pick whichever is close to the client. So as soon as it becomes available, API will know it and it will send all the clients to that database service. Next one is scalability. Well, before I start talking scalability, you know, not everyone's in the same level, so let's actually figure out what is application scalable means, right? So let's say we have a web application, we have 100 users, and one day you upgrade your applications and people lost, and you start to get all kind of users. You have now, rather than 100, you have 5,000 users. Well, you have some kind of problem now because, well, probably your server is giving you problems because it's not really designed for 5,000 users per day, for example. So what do? You might have issues with the IIS and you might have issues with your database. So let's actually handle the database here since we are talking about databases. What's going to happen is you are going to get some timeouts from, let's say you have a SQL Server, right? So what you need to do is you need to upgrade your SQL Server. Mostly you have one machine and hopefully it supports upgrades, so you can upgrade your CPU, you can upgrade your memory, or you can upgrade the hard disk, depends, whatever you need. So that is the scalability. As long as your application is written right, you can do that. So what's going to happen is, okay, you have 5,000 users, next day it comes up and now you have 20,000 users. Now, this is your computer, you might not be able to upgrade it, because you might be in the maximum, right? Then you're gonna have a lot of troubles. This way, they call this scale up or vertical scale, mostly for works for SQL Server. If you are gonna have the same machine and try to have the second one in the same way, this is gonna cost you much more money because SQL Server you have to pay the licensing for each machine. The second option you have is, well, rather than having a beefy machine like that, you can have regular computers, but you can have many of them. And that calls scale horizontal scale. That's what the Cosmos DB is. And also in the Azure, they are trying to be smart with this, so they don't put all the computers side by side, because something happens to this rack, then the whole thing is going to go down. So actually they are being smart, and there's some kind of like a distance between the computers whenever actually you go to horizontal scaling in Azure, not just Cosmos DB, but anything else. Any computers about it? Any questions about it?
Sure. So you're saying you used this for OLTP in business transactions. Mm-hmm. If you used it instead of SQL because of its distribution capability and because of its scale capability, which is greater than MS SQL.
That's correct. I guess we can compare this rather than, you know, in-house SQL Server, we can compare this with the managed SQL Servers in Azure, but really then you are losing a lot of options if you try to go to manage SQL Server. It's not really the same SQL Server. You cannot do many things in there. So that's why I'm not really comparing the managed SQL Server.
Isn't Cosmos a managed DB on Azure?
You don't need a DBA. Microsoft's actually handling all the most of everything. Yeah.
So it is managed.
It is. Next one is always available. always available is one of the SQL Server actually feature. As I said before, for always available, you need 2, 3, 4, depending on your traffic, many SQL servers, and you need licensing for each of them, which costs a lot of time. Cosmos DB is actually in the package, and it doesn't cost you anything. As I said before, well, your web application, really, if you think about it, it's like a car, right? Most of the gas stations are open 24/7. If you need gas in the middle of the night, you'll find one gas station and get some gas. Well, really, database server kind of works the same way, right? So web application is your car, and you need gas. I really don't care how well your web application is, how cool it is. Without data, really, it's not going to be able to do damage. So you need the data. For that, you really need a good database server. It really doesn't matter what it is. You need a stable SQL Server or stable Cosmos DB. So whenever you need that data, you will get it back, and you will get it fast. So Cosmos DB actually gives you just exactly that. If you have only one Cosmos DB in one Azure region, your SLA is 99.99%. If Microsoft doesn't match that, actually they pay you back. There's a calculation for that, and if they don't deliver this one, they'll actually pay you back. If you have multiple Azure regions, it almost, I mean, I don't know why they don't even say 100 here, but it's like 99.9999, really. It's 100, really, almost there. So this is a great addition, because if you are using like a SQL Server or Oracle or anything like that, you need to worry about the licensing. Cosmos DB, you don't need to worry about that. And it comes with the package. Really. Next one is multi-network. Well, I used to watch Formula One races, and I don't have tips. Now I watch the cartoons, but what is amazing about them is you can really customize those cars, right? Depending on the track and the driver, you can really customize them. And most of them has amazing engines, but really those custom settings makes them win or lose. So I'm comparing this to Cosmos DB because, well, in Formula One, usually you will see the drivers, when they come out, they take this steering wheel out. This steering wheel actually programs the whole car. And when they put it back, it just changes all the settings of the engine, wheels, whatever. So I'm comparing this to Cosmos DB because Cosmos DB has this great engine, right? And if you have like SQL Server, you must know TC4 to be able to use the SQL Server. Cosmos DB is a little bit different. It actually gives you options when it comes to connecting to its engine, right? If you feel comfortable with the TC4, it has a steering wheel for you for SQL. All you have, if you know the SQL, you will know how to use the Cosmos DB probably like in 1 hour. All the comments are same, the way that you connect it, the database is same. If you feel comfortable with MongoDB, all you have to do is really changing your connection string from your MongoDB database to Cosmos DB. And your API should work, they say 95 to 96%, that 3-4%. It's really, there are some stuff like this doesn't support, so you might have to go back and work, but they are really custom comments that you can use in the API. Next one is the table API. Does anybody use table API here? Azure. Same, if you change the connection string, you can put all your data in Cosmos DB without any API changes. Next one is the Cassandra, which I really don't have that much experience with Cassandra, but it works the same way with the MongoDB table. You just change the connection string, and you start to use the columns. And the last one is the Gremlin. Gremlin is for the graph databases. Gremlin and Mongo, most of the servers are in Linux. They are database servers, and they cost a lot of money. So by just moving that to Cosmos DB, you will save a lot of money.
Can I use the graphing with the SQL together?
In
2017, you mean? Well, I'm familiar with a graphing database and I'm familiar with a SQL database and they're pretty different. And I thought Cosmos would like kind of combine the two of them, but it's not.
No, so you cannot compare the SQL, you cannot use SQL API with Gravity. They have to be different things.
Darn.
And you cannot merge.
Can I use like part of it SQL and part of it Gremlin? Like
you can have two tables and API will, you will have two APIs. In the background you kinda need to merge it yourself, but you cannot really join them.
One database with two tables that are each different.
And also SQL Server 2017 supports graph. So you can do that too. That would be probably cheaper if you have a SQL Server. So as you can see, really Cosmos DB gives you an option. Whichever you feel comfortable, you don't really need to learn a whole new language here. You know how to do SQL, you can just pick the SQL API and you will win the rest. It doesn't really take that much time to learn and other stuff. It gives you options when it comes. Control the database, update it, select it, insert it, whatever. Next one is the consultancy levels. So there are five consultancy levels in Cosmos. The default is a session, and they are strong. And you pick the strong, let's say we have Cosmos DB in two areas. When you pick the strong, the data will be available in both places in the same time, which means the latency is going to go up, and it's going to cost you more money. Eventual is not just like the name, eventually it will be there. And now you're going to say, okay, eventually, what kind of database service is that, right? But if you really think about it, Twitter and Facebook just works like that, right? You don't really see, whenever somebody posts something, you don't see immediately. It comes up. The timing is not that much better. And eventual is the cheapest one.
So if you have one region, does this apply?
It has to be the same with all regions.
So is this, what does this relate to? Is it by region, by table, by database, by what?
By database.
Okay.
Another question? So as I say, the session is the default one, and session is whenever you create the data in your session, it will be available in your YouTube. And bonus stainless and consoles, okay, I'm not going to go in that because it takes some time to really talk about that. And really the main difference is whenever you create the data, it will be available in other places in order or not.
So for your example of eBay, for example, what would be the suggested consistency level?
Strong.
Strong. Okay.
Because you'll want
so
to your data immediately or whenever it's available.
Okay.
And as I say, when you pick that, actually that's going to change your cost too. And that's one of the variables out there whenever they figure out how much is going to pay for. All right, the next one is Cosmos DB resource model. So this one here, what you see is a SQL API. So first, you have to create a Cosmos DB account. From there, you're going to create your database. And your database has the users. And each user has permissions. From that moment, for the SQL API, we use the collections. We can compare the collections, I guess, the tables, if you compare the SQL. And each collection has store procedures, triggers, and user-defined functions. So this is one of the store procedures whenever DBS actually sees that, oh, right, you know, I have a job here. But it's not really working the same way, because those store procedures are actually in JavaScript. And since our objects are in JSON, Cosmos DB team said that, okay, we can have store procedures and they will be in JavaScript. And triggers are really nice. You can use any Azure Cloud triggers. For example, you can use a signal. And whenever data changes, SignalR will change data in clients. So you don't need to write any kind of code. You can write a trigger for that, and it will do whatever it's supposed to do. And user-defined functions are working the same way. The only thing you need to know is whenever you actually use any of them, they cost more money. So because if you go and compile it, it's going to use more CPU. So that's going to cost you a little bit more than writing query or doing this from the CSV. And each collection can have documents and attachments. And I believe the attachments, I think per collection is just 2 gig, so it's not really that good yet. The second model I'm going to cover here is a table. As we can see, everything is really the same. The only thing different is our collections became tables, and our documents become rows. And you really have the ID same, and everything else works the same. Graphs is working the same way. Rather than collections, we have graphs. And in graphs, we have nodes and edges. Nodes are for entities, edges are for relations. And you can just call them by IDs here, just working, just like the collections ID. Now, partitioning. This is one of the really long, one-to-one confusing parts of Cosmos. This will make you king. Or you're really, the whole thing can just be after you reach your point. The main reason is, if you pick a wrong partition ID, there's no way you can repartition it. So all that data you're gonna put in Cosmos DB, you're gonna pay for each insert, it's gonna cost you a lot of money to recreate this. So you better know what key to use for partition. Well, to actually explain that to you, I'm going to use a container ship. And actually, one of my talk people were thinking that I was talking about like containers, like micromanagement. That's not really what I'm talking about. I'm just talking like container ship. So whenever you create a database and a collection in Cosmos DB, Cosmos DB gives you this container ship, right? And it tells you, okay, put your data in. And the only thing it tells you is the limit of this ship is 10 gig. So if you are going to need more than 10 gig, it's going to give you another ship, a container ship. Well, which is great. You can put all your data here. But whenever you try to go back and look for this data, you better organize this data great so you can actually access that data faster. And Cosmos DB won't work that much for you to actually find this data, so it will cost you less money. So there are two items here that we need to worry about. For example, let's say this ship is carrying cars. Let's say we have a web application. And our cars has an application in it. And it needs to send and get some data from your database. So, and we need to kind of go and get that, find that data every time somebody kind of tried to retrieve the data. What do you think we should put an ID for those containers? If each container is a bunch of data. And we are carrying cars here. Any ideas?
Maybe the VIN number.
Okay, VIN number is great. And well, any other ideas?
First, you need to figure out which storage container it's in. So maybe an XYZ type access to find which container.
Okay.
Store that first.
So, some people use this, for example, time or date. Because you are sending transactions, you put all those transactions in date and put them in container. Which is not really a great option because, well, probably at night you are not going to have them in containers. And when it comes to like people wakes up 7, 8 in the morning, that container is going to get large. So, really, it's not a good option because each container should be like a little bit less. Well, but what you can do is you can use the models, right? You can use the models.
Maybe manufacturer of the car.
That's an option too. But the problem is that
make it model.
You cannot really balance that because one manufacturer might make more car than another one. So the balance is going to be a challenge for them. So really, Cosmos DB does not care how many or how big those items are. Cosmos DB allows it actually when, as you say, the bin number, if the containers are smaller, because scaling is going to get much easier for Cosmos DB. So for some reason, it's going to give you 2 or 3 or 5 ships. It needs to move some of those containers from this one to the others. And it will be much easier if your container is smaller. It can move them really fast. So bin number really makes sense here. And you can put read number in each container here, and all the information about that card will be on that container. And it will be easy to find the container and retrieve your data. Each time you create a partition ID or a partition, Cosmos DB hashes that ID and puts them on the container. So it is extremely important to know your data to actually find the partition ID. Your data that you are looking for should be in your where clause.
Should be in your
where clause, like if you are researching, if you're in SQL Server, it should be in your where clause.
Where
and
clause, got it.
And you really need to study your data because, as I said before, after you pick it, you cannot change it. And that's where actually it's going to break or make you a cake for your application.
Is there a limit on the number of partitions?
No. There's no limit. All limit is each partition can be 10 gigs. So whenever actually you are creating this, Cosmos DB gives you two options. You can have partitions, or you can have a fixed size, which is only one partition. If you pick the fixed size, it's cheaper, but in the meantime, you cannot add better. So whenever you create the collections, your collection is going to be smaller, you can pick the fixed, but mostly just to be safe, you know, it's much easier to kind of make it partition ID. It will be faster. Next one is request units. So request units is the way that actually you pay the Cosmos. One request unit means that you read 1 kilobyte documents using the ID. So this is the kind of challenge here because you can do this only by using the SDK. You are gonna try to use the SQL API or you are gonna try to use the Mongo API, it's gonna be much more than that. Because you are not really reading the data, you are querying the data. So there's a difference between them. If you are going to do the same thing, 1 kilobyte document using a query, it will be probably like 4 or 5. Insert and update will cost you more money because Cosmos DB is going to do many other stuff in the background. For example, Cosmos DB actually indexes every node of the JSON. Unlike SQL Server, in SQL Server you have to tell what needs to be indexed. In Cosmos DB, you have to tell Cosmos DB what not to index. And because of the indexing, whenever you insert an update, Cosmos DB does many other stuff in the background by doing like triggers. If you have triggers, it can actually cost you more RUs for that. And as I said before, like RU is going to depend on, we talk about, for example, consistency time. If you have a strong, RU is going to be higher. Document size, your JSON document, if it's a large document, it's going to take more time for Cosmos to figure this out. Number of properties in JSON object is another dependency. We have indexing policies. As I said before, it indexes every node. So it's kind of important to tell if you are not going to search your JSON object, one of your node, it's much easier to kind of tell to Cosmos to index it. Global distribution is another one. So if you actually have multiple places, if you have one in Asia, one in the United States, it's going to almost double it. And any scripts, store procedures, triggers, depending on what they do, the RU is going to be much higher. So really, I'm comparing the request units to my upper gap, right? Let's say we have two cars. You fill them. It's the exact same car. The driver is the only difference between them, right? The first driver just pushes the gas all the way, and let's say goes 300 miles. You have the second driver. He likes to go easy, and he's more economical. And he has the same car, same gas, and he can maybe go up 600 miles. For requesting, it's working the same way. So whenever you are writing your queries, and whenever you are writing your SDK, if you will actually pay attention to details, you will pay much less because most. As I said before, read and query is different. And if you will pay attention to all of those details, if you will index less nodes, it's going to cost you less money because, well, actually pricing depends on RU, and also it depends on the disk space. each disk space are SSD, and really that doesn't look like that bad, but since we are indexing everything, it can go up really hard, really easy. And request unit is 100 request unit per second, it's supposed to it's not that much, but if you're a large company, this can go up very easy. So it is important to pick the right partition ID. It is very important to pick the right indexes. And it is very important to actually, when you're writing your SDK, try to use as much as read rather than query your database. So Cosmos DB will work less, which will cost you less money. At the end, you know, they are charging you for the amount of power you use for CPU, I/O, and memory. But if your queries are really fast, you're going to pay less. That's one of the actual problems with the Cosmos DB. As I said before, it's for the large scale LTPs, and it really doesn't have that much aggregation functions. So if you're going to try to write a report on Cosmos DB, that's going to cost you a lot of money, because as I said before, you are paying for CPU and I/O and memory, and your report, if it's going to, you know, like take some reports, I see 230 seconds, something, 1 minute to render a report, that's going to cost you a lot of money.
So couldn't you move it to SQL and then do the report?
You can. I mean, you can. But Cosmos DB is one of the, you know, the problems with the Cosmos DB is aggregation is not good. Now, let's compare the SQL Server to Cosmos. Really, it's a generation difference, right? If you think about the Cosmos DB and SQL Server, Cosmos DB is not a relational database. You cannot join it. Your document is a JSON object, and it's right there. You have to know the ID, or you have to query it and get it. All your all of your data is there. SQL Server doesn't work like that, right? You have to join and run how many tables to actually get what you're looking for. The second one is the relation attributes. Well, in SQL Server, you have a relation. You have a primary key, you have a foreign key. That's it. There is no more information about this relation. In Cosmos DB, you can, since it's a JSON object, you can create all kind of information about this relation. The second one is not SQL Server is mostly for centralized data, that right? You want to just put everything in one place and you trust from it that this is my data. Cosmos DB works the different way. They want to kind of actually get this data and put it in many places, as many as they can, so it will be available to more people, it will be much faster. Always available is really expensive in SQL Server because of the mostly licensing, costs you a lot of money. And also you need to have DBAs, and it's gonna cost you a lot of money out there too. Well, Cosmos DB says, you know, there's no schema in Cosmos DB since everything is in JSON, right? In SQL Server, you have the schemas in your table. Now, Cosmos DB, yeah, there's no schema in database level, but you still have the schema in your application, right? All your classes, all your objects becomes your schema. So if you change those objects frequently, you really need to think about what you are saving to Cosmos DB, because when you serialize your class, it's going to change, your JSON object is going to change. So you kind of need to be smart out there whenever you are making changes in your application, because your schema actually moves to the application from the database. Aggregation is one of the problems with the Cosmos DB. For example, you cannot use group by in Cosmos DB. In SQL Server, that's one of the main functions when you write reports. Group by is important, but that's not even an option in Cosmos DB in SQL API. And encryption, well, it can be really challenging in SQL Server because there are many options and you really need to know what you are doing. And usually it will cost you some kind of performance when you use encryption in SQL Server. Cosmos DB is an Azure. As you know, Azure, everything is encrypted whenever it's at rest or whenever it's moving. So encryption is already there, so you don't need to worry about it. So it's much safer. Any questions about it?
How do you, like, what kind of approach have you taken with for customers?
So SQL API, as I said before, it's mostly for OLTP. Power BI, you can make a connection.
Okay.
But you have it. So it's not like there's no options, it's just cost you more. So it really depends. I will not recommend you use Cosmos DB for report. I will try, as I say, another way to put that data in SQL Server or something, it might be much cheaper.
So just send it somewhere else for reporting when that happens.
Doesn't reporting kind of fly in the face of the rise on detra of document databases anyways? I mean, the entire point is for doing MapReduce and queue-based processing. It's not to generate reports, it's to crunch data and then if you need to report on that data, ship it elsewhere.
True. I'm like Mongray API has something coming up right now, some preview, aggregation functions. So you have options, you can try to do that, but it's kind of cool. Next one is the multi-data models. As you can see, if you're using .NET, it supports all of them. You have the option Java and Node.js, and Python is out there. Gremlin is only for graph, and we have some options. Those are the options right now for the APIs, and Cosmos DB team is actually working to add more APIs on top of them. So there are going to be more options coming. Next one, I have the SQL API here. Those are actually the functions SQL API supports. As you can see, aggregates is not really that much. That's all you can do with the Cosmos DB. And we have a lot of kind of type checkings because since everything is in JSON right now, you kind of need to figure out the type sometimes. So we have a lot of type checkings here. But also it supports geospatial. Geospatial is a GeoJSON data type. And we have some string and arrays here. So that's what the SQL API query will look like if you use the SQL API. Next one is the MongoDB API. As I said before, there's an option aggregation pipeline for MongoDB. You can actually you can enable that, and actually you can use the aggregation functions of MongoDB if you like. And there are some operators unsupported. Where and where is not supported in the MongoDB, I mean in the Cosmos DB. Many of replication commands doesn't work because the Cosmos DB has its own kind of way replication works. That's never gonna work in Cosmos DB, but that's my guess. And the write constraints specified by client code is ignored because the structure of Cosmos DB. So it doesn't really let this tool happen in MongoDB. Anybody using your MongoDB? The next one is the Gremlin API. Gremlin API is mostly is for graph databases. In Gremlin API, for any graph applications, you have vertices, which is the nodes, which are the entities, and you have edges. Edges are for relations. Here's an example for the Gremlin. So what we are really doing here is we are creating an entity named person. Then we are adding some attributes, which are the properties. So we are saying the ID of this person is Thomas Wan. His first name is going to be Thomas, the last name is going to be Anderson, and he's going to be 44 years old. So we create an entity here. After that, we're going to create a relation. And in relation, we are just finding the vector first, which is the on the vertices first, which is Tom. And I'm saying Tom knows Robin. I'm just adding that relation here. SQL Server just added this one for 2017 version. You can do this in SQL Server now. And Cosmos DB supports it. So if you have an application supporting Gremlin API, you can actually start using Cosmos DB by just changing the connection string. And data returns in graphs, which will be JSON, that's for the graph format. Now, I'm going to actually start here how to create all the SQL service. This is the Azure Cloud here. All I have to do is find the Cosmos DB. I'm giving a name for it. From that point, in this point, you should know which API you are using. So we are going to pick the API here. And I'm just picking the source group and just click create here. So this is going to create my Cosmos DB service. I pick the SQL API. now I can actually start to create my databases. So I'm creating a global catalog database by just clicking the new database and just click OK. Now I have my database. I can start to create my tables or collections, whichever you want to call it for SQL. So I'm creating a table here or collection here, products. Here's a long, big question. This is the partition that I talk about. Each partition is 10 gig. So what I'm really saying is, do I need more than one partition on that? And I'm just picking fixed here. If you pick the unlimited, it's gonna actually ask for your partition ID. So this is the place that actually you are gonna define your partition ID with no data. So that's where the actual partition has become very important. And also, this is a scaling. I'm just scaling 1,000 RUs per second. You can always go back and change it. So if your application gets popular and the RUs are not enough anymore, you can come back here and change up number. Go up or down. What will happen is if you are going to hit the Cosmos DB and your RU is going to cost more than 1,000 per second, Cosmos DB is going to decline the request. And the API is smart enough to actually try again in the next second. So you will have some latency out.
Is that per replica then?
Is that what?
The replicas across regions, is the throughput per replica or?
Just for the per database.
Okay.
So the next one here, I'm just showing you here. I talk about the indexes. So this is the place that you will create an indexing policy. And this is really going to tell Cosmos DB what not to index, if you will have an indexing policy. And also, under the products, scale settings, if you need to change the throughput, this is the place you need to come back and change it there.
When you choose 1,000, is it pricing it based on what you chose or pricing it based on actual?
What you choose, 1,000. So if you actually put a big number, you will pay for it. And actually there's a calculator for that. So what you can do is if you know your JSON object, you can just upload it and you can play with the numbers. I think it will tell you like generally how much are you might need. So there's a kind of calculator on their website. Next one, global distribution. So this is going to be how easy it is really. So what I'm doing is my application is available in Virginia, and I want to make it available somewhere else. All I have to do is just pick another data center here, which I'm going to pick to Canada. And from here, I'm just going to save it. And that's it. My data will be in Canada less than 30 minutes, as long as my data is less than 100 terabytes. That is, try to do that in SQL Server. Let's see how this Now I'm going to actually demo some of the tools Cosmos DB has. The first one is the emulator. So when you open the emulator, that's what it looks like. Really supports SQL API or Mongo API. You just need to get the connection string and put that in your application. If you are really ready to go, they actually create some kind of applications here, so you can just download them and see them. From here, you have an Explorer option. Just works like the Azure, really. As you can see, I create a database, SQL API, and I can create a new collection here. The best part about this is if you try to do this online, you're going to pay for it. In the emulator, it's localhost. You don't need to pay for it, and you can play with it as much as you need. So let's actually start and create something in local. I'm going to create a database named order tracker. I want to track the order from the database. And my collection ID is going to be, let's say, orders. That's really my table. Then I'm picking, well, actually, let's pick element, which is going to ask me my partition ID. So in this moment, we kind of need to know what kind of data is going to go so we can actually pick the right partition ID. So before we continue that, let's actually look at our model. The model that I want to try to put in Cosmos from SQL Server. So this is my table. That's the data I want to put in. So we have some sales data. And in here, I think I am joining two or three tables to get this data. Three tables. So we have orders, we have customers who order the orders, and we have the people we are going to get who was the salesperson. So it's pretty simple. And here is what the data looks like. So we have ID, we have some order ID here, customers ID, and we have some customer information, and we have the person who will sell the item. We have some information about it. So by just knowing this much about my data, if it comes to the partition ID, what do you think the best partition ID for this model?
Order ID.
Order ID?
No.
No, it's an option. Any other ideas? Let's say we are the Amazon, right? And we are going to create this. We are going to check our orders. And this is the model that we are trying to put in focus. Any other ideas?
Does it support ranges like the SQL partitions do?
So if you go to order ID, in each container is going to have only one order, right? So that's the lowest level you can go. But the problem with that is every where clause is going to have your order ID in it?
No. Customer ID.
Which one?
Customer ID.
Customer ID. That makes more sense because, well, if you're at Amazon, when you go to Amazon and make the login, what you know is user ID. And if you know the user ID, you're going to put all information about that user in one container. Doesn't matter where it is, right? And most of the users, well, hopefully they're going to have some kind of same kind of data. And the balance is going to be much, hopefully, better. Even somebody is not registered, you still need to track that by user ID because you need to remember that shopping cart or whatever. So user ID kind of makes more sense. Does that make sense? Okay, so let's go back to emulator then.
So what happens if for your given partition key here, like customer ID, let's say that one customer exceeds that 10 gigabyte partition limit. What's going to happen there?
Well, if you have a partition ID larger than 10 gig, then you have some architecture problem.
Okay.
That should happen. So probably.
So we're assuming one customer. Yes.
That means you picked the wrong partition ID. You have a problem.
Or you don't, because somebody bought a whole bunch of stuff.
So what happens on unlimited when it exceeds the 10 gig?
So unlimited means that this data table is going to get larger. So there's no limits. So if you pick fixed, it's going to give you one container ship.
Oh, so
if you pick unlimited, it's going to grow as much as it wants. So I'm going to add customer ID here. That's going to be my
two. Like customer ID and region or country.
So you can do it if you like, depending on the structure you have. JSON structure we can. And also we have a unique key here. I'm not going to add it, but my unique key should be order ID, right? I should not have more than same order ID many times. So it's almost like working like a primary key in Cosmos. It will cost you more RU if you want to use it, but still. And you can add multiple unique keys if you like. So all I had to do is here click OK. So I'm creating a database named order tracker, and my collection ID is going to be orders.
So you can still find it. It's just you're not creating a key for it, for the order.
And if it's a primary key, like the unique key, you can find it. If you try to insert another one, it will totally matter. So my database is here, and I have a collection in orders. If you look at the documents, it's going to give you, you can say select all from C, just like SQL, T-SQL wrote it. It does nothing in it, so nothing comes up. You can create store procedures here, and you can delete, you can do all kinds. All of those are actually the same with the Azure online version. With the scale settings, you can go and change the scale options. Your indexing, you can test all of those options before you go live. That will save you a lot of money. Store procedures will be here. You will define functions and triggers. So that's how to set up the localhost. The next one we are going to look at right now is let's try to actually insert some data. So let's see how actually it's going to work. There is a data migration tool from Cosmos DB. It has been out there for some time since the document DB, but now actually supports more destination and source options. So this is what it looks like. It's just like a Windows application. You pick your source, you pick your target, and there are some advanced options out there. But what I'm gonna actually demo here is the data that I just showed you in SQL Server. I'm gonna pick that, and this application is actually gonna generate JSON from that table, and I'm putting the Cosmos. All I need to, you need to change when you go to online is the target. Right now is a target I'm going to use the localhost. So I don't need to pay any other use Microsoft for this. So let's do that. Here. For the source, I'm picking SQL from here for the list. As you can see in the list, there's all kind of options. I'm going to try only the SQL here. This is my collection string for the SQL server. And I'm going to use my query. The nesting operator here is interesting. I'm using dot. When you see the dot, it's going to actually create a child on that object. So from here, I'm going to go back to targets. And for targets, I'm picking the document DB. Those are the options. You can do bulk, or you can actually put them in a JSON file and look at them later. And if you want, you can create an indexing policy. I'm just going to ignore that right now. For the localhost, one important thing here is this last option, connection mode, especially in Windows 10 and Windows 7. This default is direct TCP. It will fail because of the firewall settings. You need to pick the gateway for it to work. I'm pick the gateway here. I'm just going to ignore the rest. So let's look at our data one more time. The query is the same query that I just actually showed you. So I'm going to take this data here. The migration tool is going to take this, create a JSON object, and put it in the Cosmos. That's the problem. So all I have to do is in this moment, just click next. It's going to give you some kind of summary what it's going to do. And I picked the select top 20, so I just put 20 rows to the Cosmos. Now we can go back to emulator and look what it looks like. Now, all I can do is go back my documents here. So, as you can see, the first one is the ID, and the second one is the partition ID. Since we put the customer ID partition, all partitions are same. You can click on it, and you can see that our object is in JSON format, and customer is different, salesperson are different because I use a dot for creating those objects in the JSON. So this is really great. You need to kind of, you know, put some data from SQL Server to Cosmos DB. You can use this tool. It's free. And it supports many destinations. I mean, many sources. It doesn't have to be SQL. So if you're in Mongo, you can use it too.
So that the doc that you gave, that's how we're getting all this nested.
Yeah, it just whenever it finds a doc, it just creates a nested object. Next one I have here is VS Code Extension. So there's a Cosmos DB VS Code Extension. You can just download and it's free. It's there. That's what it looks like. So you can query only graph tables with the VS Code. It looks nice. It actually shows you the graphs. And you can just go and look at your store procedures and other stuff. It's functional, but it doesn't do that much. So you cannot really query, for example, if you have a SQL API, you cannot query. You can look at it, it looks cool. That's it. So, but it has some other functions, like, you know, you can create a Cosmos DB accounts and other stuff, but when you come to the data and then you try to look at the data, it's not really that good. So, let's look at that how it looks. Is there an internet here that I can connect?
Yeah.
Actually, because I have accounts on the online too, so we can actually connect out there too. So let me actually look on my
phone. You can go to the Rock 2.5 gig, and I'll give you a password if you're ready.
Well, let me see my phone.
Okay,
yeah,
sure.
That might be fast.
You're in?
No, I think this is it.
Okay.
All right, so let's look at the VS Code. Now, we have three options here. So those two are online. The third one is the local host. So let's look at the local host first, because we know that we can work for sure. So this is my SQL emulator. When you look at it, this is my data I just inserted. You can see the data there. As I say before, you cannot do that much. You can just click on them and you can look at the data. But that's the problem. But if you have a graph database, it's different. You can actually query the graph database. So let's see. For example, I have a database here, Grammar database in Azure. And if you look at my graphs, this is my products table. As you can see. So what I try to do here is there are some products. So I'm using the Kindle here. And I'm just creating relations between Kindles or other products. I'm picking what is they like. So I'm just saying Kindle selling they like is Kindle selling kids. So Kindle selling they like is Kindle 8 or whatever. So whenever you make a search, or if you're in Amazon, you go to the website, product of the Kindle selling. At the bottom of the page, it tells you other products like this one. You can actually do it this way from the graph database. And this is what it looks like in JSON format. And you can actually query the graph database from VS Code. Unfortunately, you cannot do it for the other APIs. Not yet. Okay. Any questions so far?
Back and kind of look at your data, now, you may have like one customer that has many orders. Is there a way when you do that data migration that you could make a, like an object like that where it automatically generates lists as it's like channel objects?
That will be more likely from SQL Server. You can create the SQL with the query like that and it will create it for you, but there are other options other than dot, which is a nested approach.
You have to
kind of
create your query to give you that structure.
Yeah, as long as you can create with the query, it will just insert it for you, but there are more, you can just create something.
Are you
next.
Using this at all?
I'm just using in my, not in my company, but I'm just using in my self, really just trying. The next one we have is the ODBC driver, which many people don't even know that it exists. With ODBC driver, you can do a lot of things that Cosmos DB might cost you a lot of money. For example, you can actually access Cosmos DB from your management studio, and you can write, select regular T-SQL select statements, and this will actually convert the data and bring it back to you. Or you can use it for the Power BI. I don't know how much that will cost you, but there's an option. So, you know what it looks like. So you have to go to the Cosmos DB and find the ODBC driver link. And from that point, we are gonna use your keys for it to work. So here, let me show you what it looks like. It's just like ODBC setup, really. You open your ODBC setup from the Windows. And from this moment, you just run this link and it actually installs ODBC driver. And when it's actually installing it, it's going to ask you so that's what it's going to ask you. It's going to ask you the host, which is going to come from your Azure page or the localhost page. Access key is going to come from this page too. So you just need to copy and paste them really. I'm just saying current user over here. This part is easy. The difficult part is when you've got the advanced options. For this thing to work, you almost need to denormalize your data, right? Your data is in JSON format. You have to kind of tell the ODBC driver how to put this back in SQL Server way. So everything will be in like roles. And to do that, you have to go to advanced options here. And create schema editor. You have to create your schema. Since Cosmos DB doesn't have schema, you have to create it here. And I'm not really going to go and try to explain here, but really what you really need to do is you have to map your JSON object to SQL Server table. So you almost need to kind of denormalize it. That's going to connect my table. And as you can see, you are going to really define what the driver ID is in SQL. As long as you do that, the next thing you need to do is you need to go to Management Studio and create a link server. Here's the Object Explorer. Link servers are under the server object. If you look at here, I have a Cosmos. So whenever I actually run my queries, I can join to the Cosmos DB file. As I say, it will cost you money, but it's there. And it works with the Power BI the same way. So Power BI, you can use the Cosmos DB as a source.
So is this really usable at this point?
ODBC driver?
No.
Cosmos DB.
Cosmos.
Yes. As many big companies are using.
You don't care about the price.
Actually, sometimes actually, you know, not if you think about the SQL Server, it will actually save you money in some circumstances. It's not for everybody for sure. So if you're a smaller company, actually that's gonna be my next topic here. If you're a smaller company and if you like what Cosmos DB offers you, and if you have the SQL Server 2017, you can almost create what Cosmos DB can do for you in your house in the SQL Server. To do that, you need to, for example, in here, I'm creating a table. just like a regular table. I'm just saying summaries. I have ID here, invoice ID, and summary. Summary is going to be kind of our char max, which is going to actually store JSON objects. And the left side here is 2016 and earlier. Right side here is a 2017 and later. The difference between them is really the column star index. When you create a column star index in a table, it's going to compress the table and it's going to put them in memory. So the things are going to go really fast. So what I'm going to do here is I am going to add the same table, same data in different databases. I am adding around 3.5 million JSON objects in this table. As you can see, if you look at the size of it, if you have the same table with not column store indexes, it takes 2.6 gig space. If you add a column store indexes, it's going to put 332 megabytes. So your data is much smaller. That means it's going to actually access much faster. And your objects actually is going to be JSON. It's not going to be like a regular relational database here in this scenario. So next, what I'm going to do here is I'm going to actually run this query. This query really doesn't make sense. The important part about this query is I have all kinds of aggregations. So what I'm really doing here is I'm going in each 3.5 million JSON objects, and I'm trying to get this driver ID from each of them. After that, I'm getting the average of them. It doesn't make sense, but it's going to do it anyway. And on top of that, I'm going to do the group part. So if you try to run this in SQL Server, the 3.5 million rows without JSON, it's going to be a challenge. In this point, I'm going to run it. And this is the result. This one takes 40 seconds to do this. In column store, it takes 11 seconds to do this. So in Sunday, you'd like to use the Cosmos DB, but your company is not big. You can still use the SQL Server and create the environment like what Cosmos DB has. Yeah, it's not going to have all the global distribution and other stuff, but you can actually query, you can put the JSON in SQL Server and use the JSON functions to actually retrieve that data.
But if I want graphing, I've got to use Cosmos.
SQL Server 2017 has graph tables. So you can have that.
It's also just interesting. Just a note, I think SQL Server 2016, they gave you, there's like a check constraint you can add for the, if you're trying to store JSON and like in var char.
Yeah, so it's JSON, so you can add it as JSON, as long as it's JSON, it'll turn true. So that's another option that you can do without the Cosmos DB. It gives you some kind of environment like Cosmos. That's all I have for you today. I hope you'll like it, you'll enjoy it. Any questions? Okay, is it?
Any just thoughts, comparisons to like the big competitor DynamoDB on AWS?
Unfortunately, I don't have that much information for that. Okay. That's right. I don't feel like I'm not going to be able to answer that.
So, for a small company, I take away all SQL Server 2017.
That will be cheaper, and graph tables and JSON object is the same under the same roof, so you can actually grow this.
Is the Cosmos DB Emulator free?
It is free.
Okay.
Did you use the Docker one or the little like executable installer that they give you for the emulator? I'm just kidding.
I just replaced it.
Thinking about the triggers and stuff like that, first of all, it would be great to pump some TypeScript in
there.
But you said it, we have the availability to touch other Azure services. Would it be possible to say, spit things out to an event store, like that, and then use that after the fact?
That sounds doable, but I don't really have that much information. format and say, yeah. I know some people use the table API to store data there. I know some people don't. Another question?
All right. Thank you, Hasan. Appreciate it.
Thank you.